We have tons of registrations today, and it makes me really happy to welcome you all to today's webinar about billing structures. We started this pretty much a year ago. I think it's probably the anniversary webinar. And we started it right when the first lockdown hit us, and we started with, you know, how to cut your cost, and we started how the CARES Act can help you. Some of you have been very loyal participants of this. And we morphed into a business success skill webinar because we really feel we can provide, you know, insights for every one of you who do. And Kelly, you just said it, who do 85% of their work is actually business and only 15% of your work is design. So we're very happy to provide that. We would also love if you spread the word on Instagram, take a screenshot, you know, I think you will find all of us four also on Instagram. And yeah, spread the love so that next time even more people can join. I think this is really about helping the community and growing together. Before we start with all those questions, I would love to introduce the three masterminds and creative powerhouses that I have with me today. And I would love to start with Kelly. Kelly founded Joy Street Design in 2011 with a simple idea in mind, that everyone deserves to live in a home they love, which can only be achieved when a space is personal, functional, and comfortable. A former lawyer, Kelly earned a law degree from Stanford Law School and a business degree from Emory University before pivoting and studying interior design and interior architecture at the University of California in Berkeley. When she isn't designing, you can find Kelly traveling the world with her family and gaining inspirations for her projects or working on her nonprofit Joy Street initiative. Kelly, it's a real pleasure having you here today. Thank you for joining.
Thanks for having me. Excited. One of my favorite topics.
Yeah, I think we all shared that. Natalie, thank you for joining too. Natalie was born in Buenos Aires, built her career in finance and business, so another business background here on the panel, before starting her own interior design firm based in Brooklyn. Featured as a 2017 rising star by New York Couches and Garden, Natalie has been published in numerous interior design publications such as Architectural Digest, Elle Decor, Veranda, House Beautiful, TV segments, and many more. Traveling the world and visiting glamorous cities and places inspire Natalie to create one-of-a-kind ambiances. Natalie, also thank you for joining, and another travel fan. Soon we can resume that. So thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
And then Gillian Segal, after completing her Bachelor of Art degree, Gillian pursued her true passion for design by attending BCIT's interior design program. After earning her CID and working for some of Vancouver's top design firms, Gillian decided to start her eponymous design firm. She describes her personal style as modern, eclectic glamour. Inspired by her travels and love for design for decades past, Gillian loves blending the old and the new. Gillian is also an interior design contributor and writer for MarthaStewart.com. Gillian, thank you for joining out of Canada.
Thanks for having me. I'm so honored to be here and with such great company.
So am I. And I introduce myself really quickly. I'm Benni Frowein. I'm Schumacher's president. And I guess the host of this webinar. So this is a really interesting topic. And I would just, you know, to make it even more exciting, I would like to, you know, start and warm up with a question to all of you, where we are catching you today. And I would love to know a little bit more about the room that you're sitting in right now. And I can already guess. So why don't we start, Natalie, you alluded to it already earlier to the smaller group here. So tell us where we catch you and a little bit about the room.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. So I'm, like Benni said, I'm based in Brooklyn, but right now I'm in Florida. I'm in Boca Raton. I just arrived yesterday and I'm located in my mom's art studio. So you can see the paintings around.
That's so fun. Thank you. Gillian, where are we catching you?
I am at my office today in Vancouver. So I'm happy to be at my office. I have a my security guard here with me who's hanging out. So yeah.
Very cute. Good. So we all can feel safe.
Yeah.
Good. And Kelly, what about you? You have a beautiful backdrop.
Yeah, I'm actually in my office too. The back wall of my office is actually a mural that we had painted when we first moved in, and it's now become an amazing Zoom backdrop for the last year. So it's I try to take most of my calls in here.
Amazing. And for everyone who is listening, I forgot that you have a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. If you have a question, if you want to know more, please feel free to use that button and answer your question or write your question. Since I have to think, speak, and read at the same time, try to make the question short so that I can do that in parallel. But you're very, you know, very actually encouraged even to, you know, participate. We would love to address your questions. Kelly, maybe I start with you now with the first question about billing structures. You know, so much has changed over the last year, and we're doing a lot more through Zoom, a lot more virtually. You know, I think a year ago, we all thought, oh my God, how is this industry going to survive? Then 4 months later, we felt like, oh, this is actually not too bad. And I think we all today see that the home industry is just through the roof. So there has a lot has happened. Has any of your client asked you to adjust the way you've charged? Has there anything changed?
Luckily for me, it really hasn't changed because the way that we bill, we're flat fee. So as a former attorney, I have PTSD from billing by the hour. So I refuse to bill my time by the hour. We also, you know, think of ourselves as what we provide as a value, and it's not something that can be quantified by hours. Like, all my hours are created equal, so we just give them a flat fee. So our clientele, for the most part, our clientele gets a flat fee up front, and they know exactly what we're going to charge. So I think the difference really will come from that a client might not sign on if they're uncomfortable with the overall number because they have so much information up front. So what we did, like when the pandemic first happened, and I'm sure we were like everybody else, like, oh my God, we're gonna go out of business. Nobody's ever gonna call us again. We lowered our minimum for the types of projects we would take. And so that opened up a few people who probably wouldn't have been able to access our services before, which resulted probably in lower fees because their budgets were lower. And that's part of how we build, I mean, how we structure the overall flat fee. But generally, because it's flat and they know in advance what they're going to get, nobody's been able to come back and say, you know, can we change this? Or they would just say, no, this is too much for us, and, you know, move on. And we haven't seen more of that necessarily, but it's been very eye-opening to like lower the fee, lower the overall budget number, and get different types of projects.
Interesting. And Kelly, I will definitely come back on how you get to that flat fee, because I think it's very interesting. And I'm sure a lot of, you know, participants are already, you know, trying to figure out how you do that. Gillian, but before we get there, Gillian, I would love to ask you, you know, did any of your clients challenged you on, or like made you adjust the way how you bill, or is this, do you feel like it just went the same path as it did before?
I think, as you said, there's been so many changes between when the pandemic started a few months later and then where we are at now. And I feel like things have adjusted a little bit for me with that sort of trajectory. At the beginning of the pandemic, I was actually 9 months pregnant with my second daughter, about to give birth. This was exactly a year ago, and we were super busy at the time with work, and a bunch of clients called and said, we're not going to move forward with our project. We don't know what's going to happen with the real estate market. So at the beginning of the pandemic, I was totally freaking out that I was about to have my second baby and that my business was going to go under. And at that time, we also were getting inquiries for new projects. I think people kind of realizing, oh, I'm going to be at home. I need to adjust my home to function for me differently. So we were also getting new inquiries, which was a little bit reassuring. But at that time, I definitely lowered my rates a little bit because I just really wanted the work. Since then, I'd say after a few months, kind of like you said, we sort of realized, oh no, we're actually okay. I went kind of back to my normal rates. And that's where we're at now, is sort of our regular rates. We actually recently increased our markup. So I guess we've now actually raised our rates a little bit. So it's gone from one extreme to the other over the course of a year, which I think is reflective of the year we've had.
Interesting. Yeah, and I'm gonna get more into that, I think, because I would love to hear how sensitive the market is to actually lowering or hiring your fees. But Natalie, tell us a little, have you adjusted the way how you charge? Have client ask you to do that?
So not really. Like, in a way, I think every client is different and everybody needs their own proposal. Like, usually I have two standard proposals. One is like a 30% commission. Well, I'll go into details after, but one is like commission plus a design fee and retainer fee. And the other one that most clients ask for is a flat fee. So I try to start with the commission base because in my case, I think it's beneficial in the long run, but clients don't want the uncertainty of not knowing what you're getting into. Most of the time they tell me, okay, but how much is the budget going to be? So I ask them, how much do you want to spend? Let's figure it out, like the budget together, because everyone is different. Like, some people want only high-end PCs and custom, and some clients want to mix and match. I mean, most customers want to mix and match. And so I'll get into details after how I come up with my fees, but I have like a mixed structure. So it really depends on the client. I approach them with what I propose, and then sometimes they tell me they want the flat fee and we go towards that route.
Super interesting. Maybe Natalie, we just like dive into this right away, your two standard ways of charging, or like how you come up with it. Would you walk us through this?
Yes, sure. So I do different types of projects. Some are ground up construction that involve, building like a whole house and furnishing it from A to C with accessories and everything. And then some other projects is basically like decorating, furnishing the whole house. Like, maybe they just bought a new house or a new apartment. So I treat both options very differently, because when it's construction, it's hard to do, well, at least for me, it's hard to do a markup on construction fees. So sometimes I tell them, like, ideally for me will be to do a flat fee for the construction and then a markup for the furniture that we're going to get. That's the ideal case. But most of the time it doesn't work because the client really wants that flat fee. They feel like they're getting a deal. If they know, no matter what we buy, we're, stuck to that. and then if it's furniture, same way, whether it's, I usually do 30% commission on the cost of the item, on the net price. So let's say that I'm buying wallpaper and I don't know, it's $50 a yard for the wallpaper. My cost, so I pass along the discount to my customer and I charge 30% upcharge on that markup. And the same thing for like everything that we get. However, it's not just the 30% that I'm making on this client. I also have an upfront retainer fee and design fee. So the design fee basically covers like my presentation and all the time that I spend before presenting all this furniture. So it's not a large amount, but it really depends on the number of rooms. Like, if we have, living room, dining room, master bedroom, and four other bedrooms, I try to like $2,000-$3,000 a room design fee.
Super interesting. Thank you. And you are with your clients very transparent on the net prices and the markup, or do you just give them the end price and you don't discuss that with them?
So I try to be very transparent because I work in a tight community that everybody knows each other. One minute. Oops, my Zoom. Oh, sorry. My Zoom like disappeared for a minute. So I work with, like, I work through referrals. I don't really do marketing or advertising because everyone that calls me is because someone recommended me. So I want to keep my reputation, you know, transparent and be easygoing. You know, I don't need to hide anything from anyone. So usually I work on an average of 10 projects at the time, sometimes more. It depends on the size of the project that I'm working on. And in terms of charging, like, I don't want to overwhelm myself, and I don't want to have like to do so much accounting and billing for like 10 or 15 different projects. So I treat each project differently. Sometimes the client asks me, can we use my credit card for to pay for things? And sometimes I will say, okay, you know why? It's going to save, I don't need to do, you know, bookkeeping and accounting and check the credit card statements and go back and forth, spending countless hours with my team, trying to make sure that we're getting paid exactly what, you know, what we have to pay back after on credit card statements. And then some other clients, like, I do want to, you know, get the points in my credit card or fill my credit, I don't know, just I want to like be able to charge everything myself. So I tell those clients, like, just, you know, give me a check for everything and I'll take care of all the payments.
Thank you. Kelly, you also do flat fees. Do you do this similarly? Is it completely different? Like, how do you do this in a construction and in an interior design phase?
Yeah, I think I'm a lot more stricter than Natalie. Natalie's very nice. I am very much like, we bill one way. So essentially we have three fees. We have the design fee, the project management fee, and then our markup. The design fee, similar to Natalie, covers all of the presentation, all the work up to the point of purchasing. And that is a fee that is based on a value that I've created. Essentially, I've looked at past projects. We've kind of figured out how many hours it took, probably doubled it, and came up with numbers. So like, for example, a kitchen, if we're doing, we don't do only kitchens, but let's say, for example, a kitchen will run you anywhere from $10,000 to $20,000 in design fees. Right, so if you call me and you want me to do a kitchen, a dining room, and the master suite, I might charge you $25,000 to $30,000 in design. Then after we-
Kelly, sorry to interrupt you. This presentation includes floor plan, furniture specification, elevations, electrical plan, everything.
Even permits that if you need it, right? So at the end of the design phase, you technically could take what we give you and go do it yourself. You know, we don't necessarily give you all the information, but you have the images, you have enough details that you could go do it yourself. So the next phase after that is the project management phase, where we help you, so, you know, identify your contract if we haven't already done it. We purchase everything, we bring it to you, all of that. And that is a percentage of the budget. So we put together the budget for you. So we'll say, okay, you have a $250,000 renovation happening. We take anywhere from 8% to 15% of that budget as our fee to manage that project. So for, let's say, I think for a 250 project, it changes based on how big the budget is. It's probably 10%. So we would take another $25,000 in fees to actually manage that construction project from start to finish. And then at the end, we do a nice reveal and everything like that.
But there you wouldn't charge a markup on, you know, a carpenter or on like the guys, you know.
Right. So by law in California, I cannot charge for labor if I'm not a general contractor. So only thing we charge a markup on. So that's what the project management fee is. It's our fee for making sure that the contractor is kind of doing what they're supposed to do, our site visits, our weekly kind of pop-ins. And then we just charge, we don't say markup, but we charge a fee for everything that we touch. Anything that I have to purchase, you are paying me to do that. So that's usually we split the discount with our clients. So if, for example, if we go back to wallpaper, we usually get a 50% discount. So if it costs me $100, you pay $150 because you get $50 off and I make $50 on it. It's much better, you know, it's better for like things that don't actually have a retail price. So if it's custom, the retail price is two to three times what I pay for it. So I'll make 100% markup on it or what have you. But we essentially are very transparent about this with the price. If they ever come back and ask, we would give, you know, give them that detail for sure.
Yeah.
I don't split the price on anything that we buy retail. We take it all.
And so, and then just Gillian, sorry, it's a long time for you to wait.
No, it's so interesting. I love hearing, this is like my favorite topic with other designers. So it's so great to listen to what Kelly and Natalie do.
Okay, good, because we're going to come to you in 20 seconds. I just have one more quick question for Kelly. Kelly, where do you draw the line between, so I think design phase and project management phase is clear. Where do you draw the line between project management phase and your purchasing phase, basically, where you charge the fee?
Well, it's all the same. So the fee, we won't purchase until we're in project management phase, right? So project management phase is literally the entire rest of the project. And we're just taking the markup, you know, as we purchase along the way. So they're not three different phases. This third fee kind of gets rolled into the project management fee too.
Got it. Interesting. Thank you. Gillian, now we want, all of us want to know how you run your business and what your billing structures are. And thank you, by the way, all of you, for being so transparent and open. I think this is super interesting.
I probably bill a little bit more similar to Natalie than Kelly. I would say that our fees, I mean, we have different ways of billing, and it's kind of a combination. So some, and it really depends on the client, it depends on the project, it depends on the scope of work. But in general, I'd say we do a mixture of a flat fee for kind of our design service and then a commission on the goods. But there are some projects where we're doing hourly plus a commission. Sometimes if the clients really can't wrap their head around paying a commission, we'll charge a much larger fee. So I really do tailor it to the job and the client. There are some jobs like renovations, for example, where I just can't charge a flat fee because I find with renovations, the scope often creeps. I can't tell you how many projects we've done where we've started with like one kitchen and end up doing an entire house. So in that sense, you get really burned on the flat fee if you operate that way, in my experience. So when we do charge a flat fee, we like to be pretty specific about what's included in that flat fee. So how many hours of revisions that you're getting, sort of how many presentations you're getting, how many months of project management. So we include our project management, unlike Kelly, we include that in our sort of initial fee. But we do try to get specific. And then our contract basically says that if you're reaching that cap on what we've done, we'll kind of say, hey, like you're approaching sort of what you had, your allowance for this. And then after that, if the client still wants to continue doing revisions or change orders, then we'll kind of add an hourly fee or like an addendum flat fee at that. So it's definitely a big mix. It's not straightforward. I feel like this is a constant discussion in our office, and I'm fortunate to have a lot of friends in the industry, and I feel like this is literally the constant conversation. We call each other, we'd be like, what would you charge for this project? You know, it's so it is really tricky and something I know we struggle with, making sure that we're being competitive, but also making what we need to be making and think we should be making. For the markup component or the commission component, we were charging a 15% commission initially. Now in Canada, we're charging 20, but we work a lot in the US as well, and we charge 30% in the US. I've found that has been pretty much the standard in the US and Canada. A lot of designers actually don't charge any markup or charge 10%. So we do a 20% because I feel like that keeps us competitive, but it's a slightly different market, I think, in Canada than in the US in general. I'm sure we'll get to this, but I just think with, you know, the markup can be tricky with everyone having access to the internet and being able to research prices if it is like a retail good. So Yeah, it's I know that's not the most straightforward answer, but I feel like it's not the most straightforward process, and it really is client specific in terms of the scope and the project. Because like Natalie said, with construction, like I'm not charging a commission, so I need to weigh my fees more heavily. But if it's furnishing, my fee will be smaller with that commission. So
Super interesting, Gillian. And I think, you know, the interesting part is on paper, it sounds so straightforward. You know, you have a design and then you charge a flat design fee, and then you purchase and you charge a handling or markup or whatever fee. But, you know, it's never that straightforward, because your client wants to, you know, get revised designs over and over, and the elevations drawn over and over. And one day, you know, it's a door, the next day it's a window. So it's very interesting how you all handle that. I would love to understand from you whether you have seen, and just coming back to this margin question, you know, you've mentioned that you went down with your prices, now you went up again with your hourly and markups. Do you think this is the time to rather increase your fees, or do you think it's the time to rather go lower? Do you see a margin erosion there? Because I think, you know, a lot of us are still trying to figure out, you know, how do we skim the milk, if you will, you know, of what's happening out there. I would love to hear your opinion on that. Kelly, do you want to start?
Sure. I did a little bit like Gillian after, you know, we realized that the market was kind of picking up. During the pandemic, we increased our budget, like we actually doubled it from what it was pre-pandemic. and so now we are only taking larger projects, primarily because we're so busy, you know, just basic market analysis. In the sense of, you know, I think that all the information that's out there does make it a little bit more difficult for you to be overly aggressive with what you're charging in markup. I find though most of our clients, and I think some of it is just the way we present it, like we tell them like we're not going to be the cheapest person, we're not going to compete with the internet, where that's just not our process. If there is something that you find that, you know, we suggested and you find it cheaper, you are more than welcome to buy it. You are more than welcome to deal with it. I won't touch it. I literally won't even move it when we go to take pictures, right? Like I will, it's yours, and everything that comes along with it, you can deal with. And I think that's a perfectly reasonable way to approach it. I make the bulk of my money in my fees, because that's what I think my value really is. And so while markup is an important part of our, you know, our business model, I would rather allow them the flexibility for the few things that they want to do to do that. We have actually only had one client do it, and it was for one thing, and it was perfectly fine. Most clients don't even have the time nor the inclination to really do the research, but we put it out there. We don't give them obviously the names of stuff to do it, but if they are able to find it and they're able to reverse search or whatever we do, then we allow them to purchase it if it's that important to them. It's not worth our headache and kind of ruining the relationship for something, you know, for $200 here or there. You know, it might be a different situation if it was everything, but generally it's not worth the headache.
Interesting. Natalie, how do you see where the market is steering? Do you think this is the time to increase rates? Do you think let's wait a little? Do you think, oh, the competition is going to be even, you know, higher between interior designers and you're going to see a margin erosion? Where do you see the market going?
I think the industry is booming. The past year, everyone, you know, people are spending more time at home and they're trying to see what else, you know, what they can fix, because they're sitting in their house and they realize, you know, my kitchen needs an update or my room. So I think on the opposite, like it's a time to increase prices. My prices really depend on demand. So I'm always busy. It's always busy. So I choose how I want to spend my time. Do I want to, you know, do 20 projects and charge less, or do I want to do 10 projects and charge more? So the answer for me is do 10 projects and, you know, charge more. So every year, I don't have like an exact formula of how much I increase, but every year my prices go up, because first my portfolio keeps building up, my reputation, you know, gets better supposedly. So I try to choose my clients. Like I get phone calls, I get a lot of phone calls with prospective clients, and I'm lucky to be able to say yes and no based on my timing. If I like the project, if I like the person, if I'm going to get along, all these projects usually take, you know, between a year and two, sometimes longer when it's ground up construction. You're seeing the same client for like 2-3 years because you're furnishing, you're decorating, you're building. So it's like a very important relationship that I have to make sure that I'm charging correctly and that I'm making my time worth it. So definitely like prices should go up with inflation, with the market, with demand, with everything.
But it's very interesting because as you just said that it's a demand and supply, you know, and as much as you might go down in prices if there's nothing going on, you might go up in prices when, you know, everyone is just trying to work with you or with us, you know, in general. Very interesting. Gillian, do you?
Oh, I can add it later. It's okay. I wanted to say something that I always do.
Go ahead.
So I have like I love Excel. I always do these spreadsheets. You know, for me, Excel is like the best way of feeling and everything. So anyway, I have this Excel spreadsheet that I check here and there, that it's like a calendar from January to December for the upcoming year. And I list all my clients, my existing clients and my prospective clients. So what I do is I say, okay, January, like, you know, not everybody pays at the same time. So I'm like, January, who has to pay me and how much according to the contract, you know? So I calculate how much money I'm making in January and February. So like, I know from today how much money I'm going to make in the next 12 months based on all my existing clients. So that's a way also that I use to help myself if I want to take a bigger project and charge more, or a smaller project and just be comfortable. So.
Yeah, very helpful. Thank you. Gillian, how do you feel about the market overall? Like, is it for you time to increase the rates because of demand, or how do you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, aside from the sort of blip at the beginning of the pandemic when I just got so nervous, I'd say every year we try to increase our rates, similar to what Natalie said. You know, I think a big part of it is that each year our network grows with clients who are referring us to other clients, since referral is a huge part of our business, and also our portfolio is growing. You know, press coverage that we're getting, I feel like, you know, we always try and make the last project our best project ever. So I feel like every year I'm growing as a designer too. And I feel like with that comes increased rates. And, you know, it is totally, I think, a supply and demand thing as well. I mean, we get inquiries every week for new projects. And I feel very fortunate that I can sort of make sure that it is a good fit for us and something that is inspiring, or with a client who I'm inspired by or get along with. Because as Natalie said, it, you know, I have clients who I've been working on projects for 5 years with them because I feel like design is never done and there's always another little thing to do, and it's kind of a marriage. So I feel like as much of it as it is for them to pick their designer, I feel like we need to pick our clients. Of course, when I started my business, I would take anyone who had hired me because you're starting and you're trying to build a reputation and build a portfolio. But I feel like once you are more established, it's a really great position to be in, to be able to really like interview your clients as well as have them interview you.
Yeah. So we got a lot of questions in, and I would love to answer as many, to read as many questions as possible, and then for you to answer as many as possible. What I would suggest is that I read the question, then whoever of you, you know, knows the answer or wants to answer first, you just go, and then we only have one person answer the question, then we move on. I think we have 30 questions right now. So maybe we do a quick Q&A session. So the first question comes from Shirley asking, how do you come up with the overall flat fee per job? Is that ultimately based on estimation of hours, or what is it based on?
I can answer.
Perfect.
So I usually make a list, like, you know, by room, of everything that's going to be required. So I made like a whole spreadsheet with every room, every item, labor, material. So once I have a total number, I calculate 30% from that total number. And then I add a little bit extra because I know I'm spending extra time. So like usually when I do just commission, I have that 30% plus the design fee. So I add the design fee on top of that number. And that's how I come up with my number.
And I think the spreadsheet you probably also can just use on every project and you just adjust it, right? Once you know what you put into a living room, you just like use it over and over and adjust it every time again.
Right? Yeah, and it's adjustments because also like some people, like some clients want, you know, it's a higher end house or if it's a summer house, they are not expecting to spend as much as a full-time home. So it really like I change it and I make sure that I go item by item, depending on the client and the home.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, for me, it's a little, I want Natalie's spreadsheet, but I don't have anything like that. Essentially, I came up with these numbers when I worked by myself. And over the years, kind of what we were just talking about inflation and just increasing the numbers, I've increased them. And my team, I'm not that great at it. They do track their hours. So we go back to projects to make sure that we're coming in under, you know, we're still making money on the numbers that we created. So like the numbers I mentioned earlier, they are not based on actual hours or anything specific. It's more so the size of the room, the kind of, yeah. Here's what I'll say, if I'm being completely honest. I expect to make 20 to 25% of a client's overall budget. That's my goal in every project. So a lot of times that dictates what the flat fee will be as well. So if I know that the client has a, you know, $500,000 budget, then my design fee is actually going to be a little bit more, even if calculated in by room might be a little less. So that's just kind of my goal. And if clients would go for it, I would just ask for the 20% up front, but they never would do that. So we do it in these multiple different ways.
Yeah. Thank you, Kelly. Next question. How do you handle flat fees when the client challenges and says they did not get their money's worth? Or they did not like your design. How do you deal with that? And with regards to the flat fee? Who wants to go first? Gillian?
I'll go first. I've actually never had a client say that they didn't feel like they've gotten their money's worth. I've definitely had a couple of clients where they haven't liked a design. Generally, we will, you know, it's a relationship. And I feel like for the most part, if it's the right fit of a client, client designer relationship, it is a partnership and we're working together to come up with something that everyone feels great about. So if they're not happy with the design, that is generally happening in the design phase where it's really easy to change a design or change a drawing. And we really do try to use a lot of the tools at our disposal, whether it's renderings or mood boards, to really help them visualize what they're going to be getting. I always tell my clients, I don't want you to get to the end of a project and say, this is not what I was envisioning. Of course, mistakes happen, things happen. People sometimes are envisioning something different in their head than what it turns out like. And so we do work really hard to make sure that at the end they're happy. So I feel like, you know, 95% of the time they're super happy. There's been a couple clients where, you know, we've gotten midway through the project and I've had to even step away and just say, look, like I think our vision is too different. I don't think this is the right fit, and kind of fire the client or quit or whatever you want to call it. But I think for the most part, if you have trust with the client and designer and, you know, you interview each other at the beginning, then everyone is invested to make it great.
Yeah, interesting. I think also it's all about communication and having them be a part of it. Kelly, I got a question. Do you mark up on items that can only be purchased retail? How do you deal with that?
We don't buy that many retail products, but we don't mark it up over retail. That's one of our in our contract, I think we need to say that. So let's say we go to, you know, a West Elm and I get 25% off. I keep the 25% off, they pay retail. So we mark it up in a way, but it's not over what they would have paid.
Yeah, interesting. And then I got a question from, I hope I pronounce your name correctly, Ruchi, asking, you know, when you purchase from trade only sources, everything, all the furniture needs to go to receiving warehouses. Do you charge for the warehouse cost or is that part of your markup?
Charge for the cost.
Charge for it.
Okay, we charge for it. The answer is yes.
We charge 15%. Like, so when we give a client a product, we just charge 15% on top for shipping. And that covers a good portion of their fee, and we charge the rest if it doesn't.
Got it. Then someone else asked, curious how everyone captures freight costs within the company and bill clients. Who wants to answer that question?
In my case, I really pass the cost of, like, I have my Excel spreadsheet with, you know, how much the client is spending, and on the bottom, sometimes I say, okay, like shipping is 15% flat, you know, flat percentage for everything. But then I still calculate on the side, like I have another cell that I actually add the cost of every shipping item. So the 15% is more like a provision to, you know, to keep it safe for myself, but I know how much it's spending. And if they're spending more, then the number will go up, will reflect.
Yeah, so you guys all charge for it and you don't do a markup on it. You just like pass it on. That's what I understand.
No. Well, I think I'm like Natalie, where we do 15%, but we also track. So if it's less than 15%, I don't necessarily give it back. You know, so it kind of balances out. So I don't know if I would consider it a markup, but it's, I don't know.
We do ours, like we consider everything that we purchase goods and services, which would include something like shipping or freight, like everything across the board is our cost plus our 20%. So if freight is a cost, we add 20%. I like to keep it with that. I try to be really strict. I'm flexible in many ways with my clients on lots of things, but I find that when we get into picking and choosing what a markup applies to and what it doesn't, it just becomes confusing for the client. And so I just kind of say, this is how it is. Take it or leave it.
How do you handle construction management fees on top of design fees if it's a new build? Gillian, do you want to answer that?
We include project management in our flat fee. I would love to charge, I'd actually, Kelly, be so curious to know how your clients respond or what kind of fee you charge on new construction for project management, because I would love to charge a percentage of the build cost, but I find, you know, a lot of the builds we're working on, I mean, the property is a few million dollars, the build is millions and millions of dollars, and the contractor is already charging a 15% project management fee. So I find that if I pitch that to a client, I feel like they'd actually laugh in my face and be like, absolutely not. So we really do kind of, we look at how many hours we think it's going to take, how long the project is, and we include that in a flat fee, although I would love to hear what you ladies are doing, because if I could do that, that would be fantastic.
Well, in fairness, you know, I'm in the Bay Area. There is no land. People are not doing new construction that frequently. So most of my projects are, you know, maybe we are gutting a house, but it's very rare we're doing a new build. We just bid on a new build, and we did a square footage fee. We did, because I agree, you can't say this is going to be a $3 million new build and I'm doing nothing but picking finishes, let me have 10%, right? So it was a more nuanced version. So that's the one, that's for commercial work, and for new builds, we do more of a square footage fee. But that's a small percentage of our project.
The questions are pouring in. Actually, we have more questions now than we had when we started the Q&A. So, so we really have to limit it now to one answer so that everyone tries to get one. I don't think we get all through it, but we try. We try hard, everyone. What do you do billing-wise? And I love this question. When a client reaches out to you after the project is actually done and still help us for advice or help, Natalie, how do you deal with that? You think like you're done and everything.
It depends on what it is. No, like you want to keep the relationship. I'm not that strict. Like, you know, I make sure that I charge what I charge, but I'm also like, if they have a question and it's not that they want to redo another room, I'm always going to say, okay, we need a new contract. But if it's something within the room, they have a question like, okay, how long is it going to take? Is it an hour or two? I'm healthy. Is it more? We need something.
Got it. Okay, helpful. Thank you. Then Shirley asks, do any of you have good time tracking apps that work with an accounting platform? I tried Ivy, but reverted back to QBooks Pro. Any of you guys have a recommendation there?
We're using Toggle, but it doesn't. Oh, nice. It doesn't hook up into accounting software. We're actually currently in the process of trying to change all that over. So, but Toggle is what we use. It's easy.
T-O-G-G-L.
Thank you. Then Jennifer asks, can you better explain what you mean by commission? Does it that this mean your net cost plus markup? And I think we can all just say yes, it's net plus markup. What do you believe is to be a relevant hourly fee in today's market for a mid to high end project? What would you say, like, if you thought in a range, what is the right hourly fee?
My fee, I have an hourly fee if they scope creeps, and my fee in the Bay Area is $245. I think it's so location dependent, right?
I don't charge hourly, but occasionally if someone calls me and they say, like, I need help to choose paint colors, like, sometimes I might be like, you know, okay, it's going to take me 2 hours, like very, like maybe once a year I say yes, and I charge like more than like at least like $500 an hour, because it's like an exclusive service that's gonna make the house for her, that she doesn't wanna hire a designer because she can't afford it. But yeah, like I'm like, okay, why not? Just 2 hours, I make $1,000 and I'm helping someone, it's okay.
Yeah, thank you. Then Pasquale asks, did you write your own contracts or did you go to a lawyer or a source online? Gillian, do you want to answer that?
Sure. I semi wrote my own contract, semi got it from actually another designer who's my mentor, and have kind of shifted it over the years as my business has changed and grown, but it is not like a 10-page legal contract. It's fairly straightforward. I feel like, yeah, it's worked for me so far.
Thank you. Then another good question here. When you do flat fees, do you collect monthly or just one or two lump sums? Kelly, how do you do that?
We collect four sums. So we collect 50% of the first fee before we start, 50% before we present the actual final design, 75% of the project management fee before we start, and then the last 25% when it's all done.
And also a question from not my question, when you buy furniture, how do you do that? Do you do it with your own credit card? Do you charge your client prior? Do you put it on your credit card and then wait for the money? How do you do that?
I always say that they have to pay up front. Like they have to give me the money. I won't buy anything until it's paid for. And my design fee, an item has to be prepaid.
We take a retainer for everything you're gonna buy. So if we're buying $100 worth of product, we take the retainer for like $90,000 and we just bill against that.
And do you keep your original rates for repeat clients, or do you sometimes also increase it, or do you go down? How do you do that? Gillian, how do you deal with it?
So if we're in the middle of a project with a signed contract at like rates from a year ago and they signed a contract with those rates, I'll honor those rates till the completion of the project. But if they come back with a new project, it's always, hey, these are rates for 2021. And I think everyone generally understands that the cost of doing business and all these things needs to go up just like everything else in the world.
Mm-hmm. We discussed it a little earlier, you know, like clients sitting at the computer, especially now, you know, in during a boring Zoom meeting and researching furniture prices and so on. How do you react to them coming back to you? Kelly, you explained it a little where you say, listen, you can perfectly buy this piece of furniture at your price, but then everything else, you're going to do it yourself. Natalie, how do you deal with that if that happens to you?
I mean, if I'm charging markup or commission, I still charge even if they choose the item, because maybe I spend hours searching for a coffee table and they find a coffee table a few, you know, weeks later by themselves. I'm like, okay, I spent several hours, so I'm still getting markup on that.
Yeah.
I just have something to add, which I do the same as Natalie, where we charge the markup across the board. Otherwise, I find we get into things where people start trying to source their own things or doing their own things to save the markup, and it just becomes super complicated. Like if it's a one-off, I'll say, sure, this like one item, but that's it. But I feel like recently there have been challenges with clients actually challenging the markup on some stores that drive me crazy, like Restoration Hardware, where they offer a trade discount to the general public. So you can, for $100, buy a membership that gets you the 20% trade discount. And then clients kind of come saying, well, I can buy it at your cost anyways. Why am I going to pay the markup? And it just, you know, I feel like there are a few other stores, you know, a lot of what we do is custom and not retail anyways, but sometimes we do have retail stuff, and there are stores out there now that are following this model, and it just totally, in my opinion, undercuts the entire industry and just makes it really tricky for us.
Yeah, on a personal level, I agree with that. And also on a personal note, you know, I obviously discussed that topic with a lot of interior designers, and I think actually that also it all starts at the very beginning in your communication when you describe your value. I think the value is, you know, this industry is, you know, as a service provider, you try to put everything behind the curtain that looks like work, and you make it all look super easy to the client. And that is when the client doesn't understand why they would pay a markup on something that they find online, because you as an interior designer, you haven't explained to them all the work that goes into it at the beginning. Because if you explain to them how much convenience they get, how much, you know, how much time you take in order to choose things, to draw them into a floor plan, into an elevation, that you deal with the delivery, with the warehousing, with the claims, with the installation, with chipped corners, you know, like you, with the workroom, like you name it. If you explain that to them at the very beginning of how much is involved in every single piece that you purchase for them, I mean, if I was a client, I wouldn't question the 20 to 30% markup anymore. I would actually feel like I'm getting a damn good deal here. And I think, but we are also trained to not talk about it because we are service providers. And with that, the interior designer, the customer doesn't know how much work each piece entails. I don't know what you guys think about that.
I totally agree with that. I think, you know, that's also part of, that goes to my philosophy about the hourly, that I tell clients, like, we've spent years creating a relationship with people. I'm the one going to market and sitting on that sofa to tell you that it's good, or, you know, it's 10 years that I've learned how to draw this room in Revit. And yeah, it took me an hour, but that's because it took me 10 years to learn how to do this in an hour. And so you should be paying me for all of that back work too. And so I think it goes, we really get into the details. I'm like, the best client is someone who's ordered something from Wayfair and got it and it was broken. They tried to send it back and they couldn't. And like, that's the best type of client, because they already know the headaches that are gonna come along with it. And you can kind of sell that service a lot easier.
I would say one other thing too, when clients ask about the markup, is that I do just try and explain that there are so many hours that are unbillable, like what you said, Kelly, about going to design fairs, researching, like all these things that you're kind of doing for all of your clients to stay at the top of your game, but aren't necessarily billing a client for. And so I try to explain to clients that that markup really covers our time to do product knowledge, understand like the newest materials, new technologies, new code, like, because we're not really billing that to one person, but it takes up a lot of our week or our month trying to research new things and continue learning. So
one designer even went one step further and said, it's actually, you actually don't have to have a conversation about, you know, whether they're going to buy this piece or not. You have a conversation about trust, because the fact that they go and think, like, the motivation behind, you know, going online and trying to find that piece starts with assuming that you ripped them off or that you don't know what you're doing, you know. And I think that is a breach in trust. And I think it's just, I found that very interesting. And it, for me, you know, my takeaway is how important it is to have this conversation at the beginning of a project and very candid and very honest, so that it doesn't become an issue at the end. Natalie, Kate Sparks asked a question, and I think you're the perfect person to answer that. I don't know whether it happened to you though. In the event that you need to fire a client, would you handle the project fee and what's already been paid versus what is still due? I don't know whether that happened to you, but.
No, I can't recall right now, but I usually have a retainer fee that it says, you know, at any point of the project, if that client for any reason like wants to, you know, break the contract, I keep the retainer fee plus all the fees that were paid up until that moment. And also like in my contract, I have all the phases for payments spread out into like 4 or 5 phases, but 50% usually goes upfront. So like I try to get the most money upfront as possible, plus this retainer fee to have, you know, security that I, you know, whether someone decides not to pay or walks away, I'm taken care of. This is to my advantage.
Got it. Understood. I got a lot of questions here also on, you know, the shipping. And now I tried to summarize that because it wasn't clear to everyone. And then you guys say whether it's right or wrong. So I think, you know, you buy furniture and you, or, you know, fabric wall covering, and on the net price, you charge an upward markup between 20 and 30%. Then on top comes shipping, and you handle shipping differently. Some of you say shipping, it's a lump sum of 15% on net. And if the shipping goes over it, I'm going to go back to the client and charge them more. If it's under it, I see it's always a balance, but it's a lump sum. And some of you said, well, I just pass the shipping on. And then I think, Gillian, you said you put a markup on the furniture piece and the shipping because you don't want to have the conversation about on what piece is markup, on which piece is not markup. So you say on everything I charge where cost is incurred, we charge a markup. Is that right? Did I listen properly?
I find that freight, especially in Canada, is a lot more expensive than it is in the US, and we're importing a lot from the US. And so freight can be crazy on some pieces and, you know, next to nothing on others. It's sort of unpredictable. So it really just is our cost plus the commission or markup or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, thank you. And then I got a lot of questions about, you know, what do you do about customers wanting more revisions, customers texting you constantly. You know, there is, if you go on YouTube, all of our sessions are recorded on the Business Success Skill webinars and Benni Frowein and Schumacher. You know, if you put this into YouTube, you see them. There's also, you know, how to find your boundaries with your customer, how to deal with your client. Watch those webinars. I think they're super helpful because there's a lot of tips in them on, you know, how you get your next project, how you find boundaries and so on and so forth. I think the hour is already over, which is crazy. It felt like 3 minutes. Thank you to Natalie, Kelly, and you, Gillian. You made this time pass super, super quickly. And I know I will watch this again on YouTube because there was a lot of information on here and in here that was super helpful. So again, thank you very much. And most of it, you know, thank you very much for being so open and transparent. I really appreciate it. And I know that everyone watching really appreciates that. We all need to stick together, especially in a time where we are booming and where demand is high. I think together we are all stronger and together we are benefiting more from it than not, you know. So thank you. And I hope to see you soon on one of your travels.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much. This was really fun.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.